this responsibility, but this morning I've been asked to step in because Jonathan and, in fact, his entire family are homesick today. So I want to be praying for them. So here I am, dusted off the guitar. We're going to worship together. Let's stand as we worship and engage in this great song, Jesus Saves. Turn to someone and make them feel welcome today. Give them a handshake, a greeting this morning.
Yeah, we did. Oh, a little fuzzy, but we did it. Shoot.
No one died. We're all together.
All right, we did it.
God is with us. Who could be against us? Oh, shoot.
So we're going to invite Sasha up here to give our announcements this morning. Tell us a little bit about what's happening. Welcome.
What a great event. I don't know how many of you were involved with that last year, but it was awesome. This place was transformed. It was really a blessing to be a part of, and actually, that's what my announcement is about here, is we do have Creative Arts Camp coming up, and this is one of the biggest events we put on here at the church. Last year, we had about 220 kids, and you know what's cool about being a part of that? I can go to the grocery store even now, and I run into people, and they'll talk about the Creative Arts Camp and how impactful that was. So, but we do need many hands to help, so I'm going to just kind of read through some of our needs here. So just bear with me here. We need bus drivers. A bus driver is a key person for shuttling kids from one place to the next. You're responsible for the kids' safety, making sure they get to the proper location, staying with your assigned class in order to help, and taking kids to the bathroom when needed during class. Really important job. You get a lot of good time with your kids. So awesome. Lead artist. So you saw the different stations we had up there. So we need lead artist is to coordinate and lesson plan overseer for the participant class electives. This person is in charge of gathering the supplies, delegating responsibilities with helpers, planning the lessons, and presenting the lessons to the kids. First assistant. The first assistant stays by the side of the lead artist the entire time. You're the lead assistant's right hand to keep them organized, help run errands, clean up, set up, etc. You help the kids with your projects, but when the kids leave, you stay with the lead artist to help out. Next position, helpers. The helpers are super important. You are there to help assist with projects, work with kids who need extra attention assistance, run errands for the lead artist, and help with classroom management. You may also be asked by the bus driver to help with shuttling kids. Almost done. Bear with me. There are many areas of service like prepping art projects ahead of time, setup and teardown, hall monitors, snack service, and donation of water, snacks, art supplies, or money to cover expenses like t-shirts and supplies. You can contact Dana or Debbie for more information or visit the, we've got a table in the back over there, Creative Arts Camp table in the back of the Worship Center. So really, this is a great, please check out the table. If you don't want to be a lead artist, if you don't want to teach, there are so many positions. I know I was the nurse at the back door last year, and so I got to see kids as they came and went, and if someone got hurt, you know, I was able to help them with that. So there's so many roles that we need, so please reach out. So I want to bring your attention to the back of the bulletin. So we have lots and lots of Bible studies going on right now, and so I'm not going to go over all of them, but I do want you to take a look. I think men have four or five options they can go to. There's some good women's Bible studies, early morning, in the evening, so hopefully we can find a place to plug in, so check that out there. We still have baby bottles in the back, so this is for the Amador Pregnancy and Family Resource Center. Great way just to fill with your extra change at home. If you don't have change, if you don't use cash anymore, you can write a check, fill that up, and we will return them back. I can't remember the date. I think it was March. Sorry, what was it? 13th. Okay, so you can return them back then. If you don't have it full by then, you can actually drop it off at the care center, which is not far from here. And then if you are new here today, we just want to welcome you. So glad to have you here. We'd love to get connected with you if you're new. So if you want to raise your hand, we can have a contact card come to you. And then you can bring that to the Welcome Center in the back. There's a gift for you. If you have been here for a while and you're like, I haven't filled out one of those I want to, you can either raise your hand now or you can just go to the back later and get one of those. It's a good way. You can put prayer requests on there. We can get connected with you. Just a good way to that we get to know you better and you get to know us. So, and last, we have offering here at Grace. There are three ways to give. There's the box in the back. You can mail in, or we have the Vanco app that you can send in. And thank you so much just for continuing to cheerfully and joyfully give to Grace. Have a blessed and wonderful Sunday.
Thank you, Sheila. Or Sasha. My name is Steve. This is my wife, Andrea. And prior to a brief message to communion, just a logistical point, we're going to have you come up after our brief message, grab a cup. The cups are combined. So you have the juice, and underneath the cup, there'll be a cup with the bread in it. So you only need to grab one. And then as you return to your seat, when everyone's returned to the seat, we will take the elements together. When Paul was instructing the Corinthians on the proper practice of communion, he wrote, "Is not the cup of thanksgiving, for which we give thanks, a participation in the blood of Christ? And is it not the bread that we break, a participation in the body of Christ? Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body, for we all share the one loaf." That's 1 Corinthians 10, 16 and 17. Communion is about a holy relationship with God through Christ and a holy relationship with other followers of the Lamb of God. We are the body of Christ, partaking of the one body and blood of Christ in communion.
Jesus started the tradition of communion. He instructed his followers to use bread and wine to remember the sacrifice he was going to make when he died for our sins on the cross. Jesus called himself the bread of life, which means that we are nourished by him, we survive because of him, and he satisfies us when everything else leaves us empty.
John 6:48-51, I am the bread of life. Your forefathers ate the manna in the desert, yet they died. But here's the bread that comes down from heaven, which a man may eat and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. This bread is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world.
There's a connection between our nearness to Jesus, believing in him, and being fulfilled by him.
In John 6:35, then Jesus declared, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will never go hungry, and he who believes in me will never be thirsty.
Taking communion does not make you a Christian. It doesn't save your soul or get you to heaven. James Boyce wrote, at the heart of the present sacrifice significance of the Lord's Supper is our communion or fellowship with Christ, hence the term communion service. In coming to this service, the believer comes to meet with Christ and have fellowship with him at his invitation. The examination takes place because it would be hypocrisy for us to pretend that we are in communion with the Holy One while actually cherishing known sins in our hearts. God actually warns us about taking communion without considering what it means and why we're doing it. The intent is not for us to mindlessly perform a ritual, but to intentionally set aside time to remember what Jesus has done and why he did it.
So in 1 Corinthians 11, 27-29, it says, therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. A man ought to examine himself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body of the Lord eats and drinks judgment on himself.
Every time we gather around bread and wine, we remember Jesus is the one who provides all we need. It is not about the bread and wine. It's about the body and blood of Jesus. It's not about the ritual or the method. It's about listening to Jesus and doing what he says. Communion is not an obligation, but a celebration. Communion celebrates the gospel. Jesus was broken for us so that we can be fixed by him. Celebrating communion marks the story of Jesus, how he gave himself completely to give us a better life, a new start, and a fresh relationship with God.
1 Peter 3:18, for Christ died for our sins once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, to bring you to God. He was put to death in the body, but made alive by the Spirit.
Again, it's not about a ritual to revere, but a person to worship. Jesus is less concerned about the method of celebrating communion and more concerned that we celebrate it. As often as we remember Jesus, we should celebrate Jesus.
Communion is important because it's a command to remember. Jesus wants us to remember every time we taste bread and wine, and even when we sit at tables in our own homes, that he is the one who provides all we need. He gives us the physical food that we need to survive, and the spiritual nourishment we need to keep taking our next steps with him. So at this time, if you'd like to come forward and grab a cup and return to your seat, and then we'll take the elements together.
My soul, mercy.
Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Thank you.
Kids are being dismissed. Can you hear me?
All right. Oh, such a sweet time. Let's continue in our worship. Thank you.
Good morning. We're going to continue in our study in the book of the Acts of the Apostles, and today I'm going to be reading to you the passage that the teaching is based on. So for those of you who can, please stand as I read God's word. We're going to be again in chapter 17, reading from verse 16 to 21. Now, while Paul was waiting for them at Athens, his spirit was provoked within him as he saw that the city was full of idols. So he reasoned in the synagogue with the Jews and the devout persons, and in the marketplace every day with those who happened to be there. Some of the Epicurean and Stoic philosophers also conversed with him, and some said, "What does this babbler wish to say?" Others said, "He seems to be a preacher of foreign divinities," because he was preaching Jesus and the resurrection. And they took him and brought him to the Areopagus, thank you, saying, "May we know what this new teaching is that you are presenting? For you bring some strange things to our ears. We wish to know, therefore, what these things mean." Now all the Athenians and the foreigners who lived there would spend their time in nothing except telling and hearing something new. May God add his blessing to the reading of the word. You may be seated.
How about now? There we go. Lots of buttons and things to keep track of up here. Welcome, everybody, this morning, and so grateful to be here. I take a breath. I'm reminded of how valuable an asset Jonathan is on days like today. Grateful. So Jonathan and Anandi and all the kids, if you're watching from home, which undoubtedly you are, welcome this morning. Hope you're feeling better soon. Before we move into the message this morning, I did want to draw attention to a couple prayer requests that I think are important for us always as we are endeavoring to hold one another as family, really. We want to know what's going on in each other's lives, especially if we're going through something that's difficult. And I just want to draw some attention to Pam and Jared Sego. Pam is sometimes singing up here with us. They have been traveling. They're in Missouri. But while there, Jared had some issues. They didn't exactly know what was happening. They thought maybe a mini stroke. They're considering the idea of seizures. But he was in the hospital for a time, and we weren't able to get that out on immediately to everybody with regard to our prayer email. A group of us were praying together who knew about it. But let you know, they did release Jared from the hospital. There's still some question marks, but he's feeling okay. Just want to keep continuing to pray for Jared. And Stephen, and forgive me, I'm not remembering his last name at this moment, but you know Stephen. He has long hair and has a goatee and a really kind, gentle person. He's in the hospital too. He's dealing with a leg infection. And so I want to be lifting him up as well. And I just, if we're just going to take a moment, if you're okay with this, I would love to, without calling you out or drawing any attention to make you feel uncomfortable about this, if you have a need that you would like prayer for, and we're not going to call it out or name it, but if you could identify yourself by just standing right where you're at, we're just going to pray for a moment. I would love to pray for you. Ah, yeah, thank you, guys. Thank you. Yeah, so much. The Lord knows our hearts. He knows our circumstance. He's right there with us all. Thank you for letting us know that we can be praying for you as well. Thank you. Thank you. And if those of you around, stay standing. Sorry. Some of you around them, just be close to them. Put a hand on their shoulder. You're not alone. We're bearing this together. And thank you for allowing me to do that. So you are not alone. We are a church family. We don't have to know the details. But it's so helpful for us to know that you have a need. So let's go to the Lord together.
Father, we are so grateful for your love and your provision, that you are with us every moment of every day. You are especially with us in those moments where it feels like you might be a little distant in our experience, in our circumstance. And so, God, we honor that space. And we speak faith to these needs today, knowing that you do hear, you are present. And I pray, God, that you would come to each of us in our need and give us exactly what we are, what would be for our good, according to your will. Heal those who need healing. Heal us physically, heal us emotionally, heal us relationally, heal us financially, whatever it is that we are facing. We invite you in and ask for your help and ask for your healing today. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. So as we continue our study in the book of Acts, just as a review, I need something to put this. Forgive me, I'm wandering here. I'm wandering out of camera. Sorry for those who are doing live stream. You can hear my voice. I'm coming back. And so just as a matter of context, remember, Paul and Silas are traveling together. This is their second missionary journey. They, everywhere they go, they seem to have some sort of success and opposition. Initial success, but as that success gets to certain ears that it evokes envy or jealousy, and they act against Paul and Silas, and oftentimes in violent ways. Paul has already been beaten in prison, both of them. And just before the passage was read today, if we reached back into like verse 14, you would see that Paul was sent away by himself at night from Berea because of the mobs that wanted to basically kill him. And Timothy and Silas were able to stay behind because they had a little bit less of a upfront role. And strategically, that was genius. So they could stay and encourage the church. But Paul had to be sent away. So Paul, he gets sent down to Athens. And he's there waiting for Timothy and Silas. He was left and gave word to them, come to me as soon as you can. So that's where we are contextually in our passage. And since the opening verses were already read by Keith so well, I'm just going to draw a few some attention to some things. Number one, if you have a bulletin, there's a space in there to keep notes. I know it's always a small space, and I say a lot. My encouragement is always write the things down that God speaks to your heart. Mostly. You don't have to write down everything, you know, right? I mean, write down the things that the Spirit of God move you, like, wow, that's something right there. I'm going to write that down. Those are the things you really want to grab a hold of. The rest, you're going to forget anyway. As much as the hours it takes to prepare this stuff, that's reality, all right? The stuff that God speaks to your heart with, that's what you write down. But I'm going to give you an outline just to help. The folly of wisdom is the idea here. We'll get to that in a moment. But when we think about the context of what were happening in these opening verses that were read, I want to draw a couple attention to a couple of things. Paul, first, is diverted south. So the road, if you're looking at the maps and how they travel from one city to the next, Paul and Silas have been traveling east to west. And now he's been diverted south down into Athens. And so that leaves us to conjecture a little bit. So we know from other books that Paul has written, he wants to be in Spain. He wants to take the gospel wherever it has not gone before. He wants to tell everybody about Jesus, whatever that looks like. And he has already been diverted from the preaching the gospel in Asia. If you remember a few weeks ago, the Holy Spirit said, don't talk in this city. No, don't share it here. Don't share it here. Where God is clearly going to be in Paul's third missionary journey, because we have the whole book of Acts available to us, but he doesn't know it. And he's traveling east to west, and we can guess maybe his heart's desire is like, man, I'd love to get to Rome. I'd love to use Rome as a launching point to Spain. Well, he once again is diverted, and he's diverted south. I don't know that he planned to be in Athens. I'll just leave it at that. So if we're trying to capture Paul's mindset, his heart, in this, he has experienced a lot of persecution. He's been driven out of city after city, and now he's been diverted potentially from his overall plans, and now he's in a city he didn't plan to be in, and he doesn't have his traveling companions. There he is. Second observation is just talking a little bit about the history of Athens. You can go visit Athens today. You can Google Athens and see all of the ancient ruins that are there. It's a really significant historically rich area that for hundreds of years was the resident place of people like Plato and Aristotle and Socrates and Zeno and these Epicurus and other major influencers in philosophy. But all of those philosophers that we would recognize, some of their names, they lived there 300 or 400 years prior to Paul. By the time Paul gets there, it's still a real strong center for philosophy and religion, but it's long since past its heyday. But it's still very robust, really important city, but that's Paul's context. Lots of influence by these philosophers that we still read about, those are present there. And thirdly, I just want to make this observation about the historicity of Acts. If you are a believer in God or not a believer in God, you cannot get around the historicity of the book of Acts. When you think about the Bible, and is it really true? Is it really a book that we should be paying attention to? How accurate really is it? Some of the external drivers of accuracy are the people and places that are talked about here, and the culture and how it's referenced and how they talk. Is that even the words they use and the places? Did they really visit those kind of places? Do they even exist? That would be a question. And this would be one of many, many examples how the Bible continually references people and places that archaeology has continually unfolded as and uncovered the reality of these places. And I would just say, by way of comparison, and I'll I mean to draw a lot of attention to this, but just to way to give weight to this, you have another rival religious book in our culture, in the cultures around the world too, called the Book of Mormon. And that is written a lot like our Bible, with a lot of people and places and so on. But the reality is there is no archaeological, historical reference of these people and places. Okay, that is a major point. The Bible doesn't have that problem. And so as just a point of history, that this is a real book written by real people in real time that is very accurate. And I'll just give you some examples, things we've already read. We've referenced Athens. All of us know Athens exists. It was full of idols. We know it was a religious and philosophical center. There was a synagogue there. There was a marketplace, which was called the Agora. These are all references that no question in the fact that we've already seen that some Epicurean and Stoic philosophers wanting to engage with Paul completely fits with that city. They would have been well-known, well-established, 300 or 400 years after these philosophers had heavy influence in that city. They're still carrying on. They use phrases like, what does this babbler have to say? That's an idiom, an idiomatic saying. In English, we use the word babbler, I guess, at some extent. But in the Greek, this idiomatic saying, it was exactly what they would have used in that day to describe someone whom they're kind of making fun of, at the same time wanting to know information from. And it completely fits. We have this reference to the Areopagus. And I have one picture for us up here that's helpful. So the high place up there, this is a modern day, obviously, picture. The high place is the Acropolis. That's where all the big temples are. You can still visit this day. And this lower section you see in the foreground is this large rock outcropping called the Areopagus, or also referred to as Mars Hill. Now, the religious center was up on the high place, and every city had a high place. Jerusalem was built on the highest place in that area. That's important strategically for the military idea, but also because they believed the higher you go in elevation, the closer you are to the gods, also why they would build on a high place. And so there's the Acropolis with all the religious centers of all things. And then you have the Areopagus, that little rock outstructure, which historically is where the Council of Ares met. This is where they would decide on the validity of certain philosophies, religions, and whether or not you can continue to preach. So the implication here is we're going to invite Paul to this place, and we're going to judge whether or not we want you to continue to have this opportunity in our city to preach the gospel. And so that's what's happening here. And historically, that's exactly how it would have happened from all the other pieces of literature and so on outside of the Bible. So I love drawing attention to this. And then we're just going to wrap this up by coming back to the close of this verse that Keith read. And again, this is reflects culturally what's happening, as well as makes a nice statement that Luke kind of sums up this section. In verse 21, it says, "Now all the Athenians and the foreigners who lived there would spend their time in nothing except telling and hearing something new." If that sounds a little sarcastic to you, you got it. It's meant to be a bit sarcastic. Yes, there's this highbrowed people who the intention here in the sarcasm is they think very highly of themselves. They are the keepers of truth. They're the keepers of all that should be thought about and the high, lofty thinking. And if you are one of these philosophers, you know, you have achieved something great and so on. So other cities around this area might say something like this about the Athenians. The Athenians would not say something like this about themselves. Like, this is all they do. They would use much more edifying language about, you know, the deep, dark secrets of life, you know, that we are sucking out of, you know, sucking out the marrow of life or whatever. That's a Thoreau quote, by the way. So that's how it ends. So that gives you a picture of where Paul is, a very real place that he's going to be in front of a council that's going to judge what he says. Is this a legitimate thing we should be talking about? And the idea was, the implication at the end is there's some, it's not completely authentic, they're asking him. Because pretty much they just want to hear what he has to say. They don't really want to say, is that really true? You know, but it's kind of a little pretentious. That's where it's at. So that's our introduction. And so now we're going to move into the rest of the text, which really makes up what Paul actually said. And there's a bunch of statements he makes. And I think this is really great because this section, I'll just let you know from a biblical scholarship type of perspective, is this passage is really widely debated. They wonder, is Paul, because he's by himself, he wasn't planning on being in Athens. That's kind of what the language feels like. And now he's going to contend with these philosophers, and he chooses a tactic with them that has incurred some criticism. And we'll get to that by the end. But there's so many good things here that we want to draw out, and we'll just walk through it, and then we'll bring it all together in the end. So what Paul actually said. So where he starts is in verse 22 and 23, and he says this. So Paul, standing in the midst of the Areopagus, very real place, "Men of Athens, I perceive that in every way you are very religious." Of course. "For as I passed along and observed the objects of your worship," remember, this is a city of idols, a city of worship, of religions. "I passed by, I observed the object of your worship. I found also an altar with this inscription, 'To the unknown God.'" Again, this is a real reference that, yes, that kind of stuff would have been there. What therefore you worship as unknown, this I proclaim to you. So Paul is opening up this is an official forum. He's been given an official hearing by the Council of Ares on Mars Hill, the Areopagus. And so here's his tactic. He finds, first of all, common ground. I'm in your city. I'm going to say some nice things about you. Hey, I see you're really religious here. And in fact, I saw one idol or the one monument to the unknown God. So this is our common place. This is where my starting point is. And I think this is a great spot for any of us. This is commonly how we tell somebody about Jesus. It's because of a common experience that we enjoy or something we have in common. That's where that's always, not always, but oftentimes an entry point for us. If we're going to tell someone about Jesus, about our faith, it's got to be something usually we enjoy together at some level. So that's his starting point with common ground. Then he moves to his statement about the truth about God, which this would be the new information to them that they're going to grapple with. So I'm going to read 24 and 25. The God who made the world and everything in it, being Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in temples made by man. So he's introducing ideas that are potentially offensive, but it's truth. Truth doesn't always feel good. So he's navigating this carefully, but he's navigating it honestly and openly. So I'm proclaiming to you, the God who made the world and everything in it, being Lord of heaven and earth, does not live, he's too big. To think about him living in a temple is not possible. Temple's made by man. Verse 25, nor is he served by human hands. Now, he's contrasting to their gods, whom are served by people. So how do they serve them? So there's all kinds of offerings you make, you know, fruit, vegetables, meats. You bring things to the altar and leave it there to food for the god to eat, basically. And this is true, and you go to other cultures in the world. You go to India Pakistan and other places that like India is a great example because they have, millions, is that an exaggeration, of gods in Hindu religion. And many of them, they offer food to these gods. They feed the gods. We want to take care of our gods. And Paul is saying, my God doesn't need any of that. He's, in fact, he is not only the source of all things, he is the one who provides you with your food. He sustains all of mankind. That's who my God is. He doesn't need any food. He's too big to dwell in temples and so on. So he's speaking truth, but it's starting to encroach upon some sincerely held religious beliefs of the people. And he ends the statement as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all man life, breath, and everything. So not only does God not need anything, our very existence depends on him. He gives us. So the three points, just to sum up, and I don't have it up here, just I'm going to speak them. One, and this is how we might talk about God. One, there is a God. He exists. Number two, he is self-existing. He doesn't need anything. He is a God who existed in eternity past. He will exist for all of time when time doesn't even matter anymore. God will still be there. He doesn't get old. He's self-existing. He doesn't need food. And thirdly, he is the source of all things, including our very breath. The heart that's beating in our chest, we owe to this God. He is sustaining it. That's who God is. So Paul is making this argument with these religious philosophers and so on, establishing the truth about who God is. And I will say this as an aside, because it's worth repeating. And you'll hear me say this with some regularity if you've been at Grace for any number of years. You've heard me say this. There are four chief questions that man must answer. Mankind must answer. Whether we agree with it or not, whether we deny it or not, they are questions that are. Number one is, where did I come from? Number two, where does evil, why is there evil in the world? Number three, what is my purpose on earth? And number four, what happens after I die? These are essential questions that every person has to grapple with at some point in their life. Where did I come from? Why do bad things happen? Why is there evil? And what is my purpose? And ultimately, when I die, what happens after that? We don't like to talk about these questions, but these are essential questions to living a robust life, to living a meaningful life. To the degree we grapple with them is to the degree that we live a more meaningful life. But it's just easier not to, and so we just put Netflix on for another binge watch. But that's really what Paul's addressing. Really, he's saying there is a God. He's self-existent. He doesn't need anything from us. He cannot be contained in temples. And in fact, we have our source from him. So he's answering several of these questions, you know, in a roundabout way. Third observation he makes is that not only do we have our life and breath and being from him, we have our origin as a species from him, mankind, right? So verse 26, he says, "And he made from one man every nation of mankind to live on all the face of the earth, having determined allotted periods and boundaries for their dwelling place." So it was not a given in this day that we had a common ancestor. There's several philosophies in Paul's day that certain people sprung up from that region through the means of the gods. They didn't really have tangible evidence of this, but that was kind of philosophies. How do we get here? And why do we look so different than our neighbors who live the next country over? We have to have explanations for the origin of languages, why we look so different from one another, and so on. And so there was lots of philosophies about that, including the example I gave. It's like, you know, we just, you know, us in Athens, in Achaia, this larger area, we just sprung up from here. That's our best explanation. But Paul's saying, no, you find your origin in God. In fact, from a single common ancestor. Now, he doesn't ever name Adam and Eve, but you understand from a Christian point of view, a biblical point of view, that's what we believe. God created man and woman. And from man and woman, Adam and Eve, all mankind over the hundreds and hundreds of years have existed and grown. So we find our origin in God, and we have prescribed limits. He's introducing this idea. We like to think of ourselves very lofty. There's nothing I can't accomplish. It's part of our American culture for sure. I'm just going to do anything I set my mind to, and so on. And Paul's introducing the very real idea of, and you have boundaries and limits. You're not going to live forever. There's limitations to who you are. God is unlimited. He cannot be. He's making a contrast. Get it? So he can't be contained in temples. He doesn't need any food. We, by contrast, need food to survive. We need God for our very heart beating in our chest. In fact, our very origin is because God said, "Let there be, let there be man made in our image." Right. So Paul is making this argument. Let's go on to the next one. God gave man a purpose. Again, one of the chief questions of mankind we all must grapple with. Verse 27. That they, mankind, should seek God. That's a primary purpose, that we would have a relationship with our Creator. We are born into this world, you and me, estranged from God. But God wants to be known, and he reveals himself to us in all kinds of ways, through our parents, through people that we meet who already have a relationship with God. The Bible makes arguments with regard to creation itself should raise the question, you know, how did this all really get here? And the expansiveness of our universe, the more we know about it, the smaller we feel. What is exactly out there? It's this yearning of seeking a greater purpose, a greater understanding. And God's saying, yeah, I put that in you. And I'm not trying to hide. I'm going to put all kinds of people and experiences in your path to get you to understand I exist and I actually love you. I want to have a relationship with you. So this is, I'm kind of giving a bigger picture of what Paul is saying here. So I'll just read what he says in verse 27 again. That they should seek God and perhaps feel their way toward him and find him. So Paul is just using everyday language. Keep in mind, Paul has not quoted a single verse yet. Who is he talking to? People who have no reference for Yahweh. They're not Jews. Not people in a synagogue, they're philosophers. So he's not used a single verse. So what authority does he appeal to? This is interesting. He moves to this. Did I already read that he's quoted scripture? I think I passed this. Oh, I was on such a roll too. So he quotes, I have to actually take my Bible out here. Let's look, it's not in my notes. So bear with me. This is important. So in making this argument, the very argument that I'm just making, he quotes their philosophers. And so look at verse 28. He's actually not far from us, the end of verse 27. For in him we live and move and have our being. That's a quote from their philosophers. And it's the same philosopher, by the way, he quotes in his letter to Titus, when he talks about the Cretans. Their own philosophers had said they're lazy, evil gluttons or something like that. That's from the same passage, the same author. He's quoting the same thing. In him we live and move and have our being. And as some of your own poets have said, he says, for we are indeed his offspring. So he is using authorities that they already have some sense of truth. And he's drawing from that and say, see, your own poets are saying the same thing I'm saying. I'm bringing to you something that they're missing. And so he sees this common ground. He points to their authority, not from the scriptures themselves, and making this argument. All really interesting. And then he moves to judgment. Like God wants to be seen or sought, and he wants to be found. And even your own writers are talking about this. But here's the trouble. We don't have unlimited time to pursue this. At some point, we will die. Remember the fourth big question, what happens after I die? And after that comes judgment, according to the Christian worldview, the biblical worldview. And Paul's saying, there's going to be judgment. Look at verse 29. Being then God's offspring, we ought not to think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image formed in the art and the imagination of man. You have already tried to ascend to who he is, and you've done it in feeble, limited ways that don't ultimately reach God. And he's talking about the futility of their seeking after God to this point. So Paul's given him the reality of their limitation based upon in sin. I'm kind of adding some language here. And finally, he gives them the call to action, and that's repentance. And that's where he finishes in verse 30 and 31. It says, the times of ignorance God overlooked. Okay, you've made your idols. You've groped, you know, in the darkness toward him. He wants to be found. And he says, okay, time's up. I've overlooked your ignorance long enough. Now you ought to act. You've been given enough information, Paul basically is saying. The proper response is repentance. I'm going to change. I'm going to change my thinking. I'm going to change my actions. And I'm going to worship the one true God. So let's just read the passage there. Times of ignorance God overlooked, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent because he has fixed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed. And of this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead. Who is he talking about here? Jesus. We know Jesus, but he's getting to his point. There's a means that we can be saved from this judgment. And it's repentance and faith in Jesus. And you're beginning to see a little bit of why people debate about this. And I'll draw more attention to it if you're not quite seeing it. It'll become clearer as we go. Time and grace are running out. Judgment is coming. There's only way to avoid the judgment, and that is to repent and come to faith in Jesus. Basically what he's saying without saying the name of Jesus. So what is the result? It's twofold. One is most of them just sneered. Like, what? Why is resurrection a trigger point for them? Basic Greek philosophy, the most popular Greek philosophies, have at the goal, at the end of life, so they've answered the question, what happens after we die? To them, the answer is nothing. To achieve, what do some religions talk about where you kind of become one with the universe after you die? Buddhism talks about this. I can't remember. You can Google it. Anyway, is the idea of that the chief end of we're trying to shed this body. We want to get rid of this body. It's prone to age and sickness and trouble, and death is like the portal through which we just get released to the universe. And we become one with the particles of the universe. This is kind of a pantheistic idea and so on. That's kind of the most popular view at this point. So if we've died and we've been buried, we've achieved kind of next level goal in their mind. And this idea that God, to redeem mankind, is going to take that old body and dig it back up. And here you go. It's like, what? No. I don't think so. Okay, so we know more as a Christian faith that when at the resurrection, just like when Jesus was raised from the dead, it's a message of triumph over death. It's a message that we are conscious beings, that we still interact with one another. We will still interact with God. We're not this unconscious existence into the universe or whatever. We do have a conscious existence. And the bodies we receive, according to the Christian faith, talked all throughout the scriptures, you know, notably in 1 Corinthians 15, that this body is equipped to last forever, never subject to death, never subject to illness, never subject to the things that frustrate us all the time, and will be in the presence of God for all of eternity. So that's the quality of the resurrection. But in their mind, that's ridiculous to think that God would take the very thing we were finally got to shove in a grave and pull it back out again. That was ridiculous to them. And so most of them sneered at this. But some believed. And let's talk about that. And Paul left. And the concluding statement is verse 34. But some men joined him and believed, among whom also were Dionysius the Areopagite. So one of the very members of the council. I don't know how public this was. If he came to them afterward, I don't know. But that's a big deal. He believed and came to faith in Jesus. And a woman named Damaris who and others with them. So these are the people that actually got named, two people. And we don't know anything else about them. This is the only time their names are mentioned. But somehow they become significant figures that the people who are reading the book of Acts, they probably understood who these people are. We know them. Oh, they became, you know, leaders in the churches in whatever city that they ended up landing in. They're very noteworthy. I love the fact that here's language that we always have to grapple with. I just want to draw attention to is this, that the biblical writers are using language that makes the most sense to their audience while holding in tension their core beliefs about themselves and their relationship with God. And here we have a little bit of a contrast that comes up all the time. I'm just going to draw attention to it just so you are alerted to this idea. And that is this. The beginning of the sentence in verse 4 says this, but some men joined him and believed. Among them, Damaris, who is a woman, among the men who believed. This is contradictory, right, in our minds. This is the idea of using cultural language, which would have made complete sense to them in the first century. When you referred to a group of people, it just culturally, that's how you referred to them, men. It was a patriarchal culture, patriarchal society. Women played a secondary role in that culture, whereas in God's eyes, women do not play a secondary role. In God's eyes, there is no male nor female, slave nor free, you know, Greek nor Jew. When we place our faith in Jesus, we achieve what God had intended for us in our how he values us and how we ought to value one another. So there is this tension here that I just want to draw attention to that we see all the time. And we'll read it, I think, later in another passage, maybe next week, I can't remember. But oftentimes, and the brothers, and what oftentimes in the context, what they mean is brothers and sisters. So you'll hear us say that from a teaching point, if it really does mean a mixed group. It's important. They're using cultural language, and they're holding in tension the reality of the theology, what they really believe about the value of both men and women. I just think it's important to draw this out. It points to the historicity of our text, as well as the liberating idea of God elevating slaves and women who were in a particular culture looked at as secondary. What we see is really the early church's viewpoint of what God really thinks about people whom we might think of in a lower standing. We do the same thing, right? It seems foreign to us. Well, yeah, I don't think of a man or a woman as one better than the other, but we do all the time in people. They don't make as much money. They're not as educated. They don't have the same color skin as me. They don't have whatever it is we use in our mind to differentiate value. And we have names for people all the time. You know, we have we call them Hicks or we call them whatever. We have our own language that we don't have any problem using. But God does not use these kinds of terms when he talks about his people. Nor should we. And so the writers are using this tension, dealing with their culture, but also acknowledging the truth of their faith. So I think it's important to point out, and there's an applicable point for us, right, believers, how we treat one another. It should be life-giving and valuing, not based upon some of these things that we differentiate on. Okay, so that's the end of this section and the result. Oh, I want to say something about Damaris, too, because Sierra pointed this out to me. She pulled this out of the named after this person right here in Acts, whom we don't know anything about, and this author creatively kind of draws attention to that reality, but the value of it. So if that interests you, book in our library. So bring me to the end here, and I know I'm running out of time, but it's so important. It's not advancing. Let me manually do this. Well, you should see the word conclusion up on your... I don't know why my computer is kind of frozen right now, so we might have to kind of wing it. That's okay. So here's our conclusion. Bringing us back to why this passage is under contention with, you know, is this the essential question is this. Is this a tactic we ourselves should use in telling people about God? And why is this such a tension? I'll point it out to you, and I'll attempt to answer the question for myself and maybe give you something to think about. Why is there contention? First of all, Paul never appeals to Scripture. We commonly appeal to Scripture when we're talking about God and who Jesus is. That's where we get all our information, right? He doesn't in this passage. Paul does appeal to their own writers. We get sometimes uptight when we quote, like our Christian writers quote other writers whom we like, wait, I don't necessarily agree with that other writer and you're quoting them, or maybe I shouldn't read what you're saying. And, you know, we have to understand we're thinkers. The authors assume we are thinking and we can make those discernments, okay? I've already tipped my hand what I think about it. I think you can quote other writers. This doesn't diminish Paul at all. He does it again when he writes Titus. But you do have to put your thinking caps on. We do have to have discernment. Thirdly, Paul never actually speaks the name of Jesus. That's probably the biggest knock on this. He never says Jesus. And almost equal to that, is he never mentions the cross. Never as a means by which we can be saved. And that is the means that our sins are paid for. You can't have a relationship with God without having your sin dealt with. All of us, we are born into this life separated from God because of our sin. And some of us sin more, some of us sin less, but every single one of us have sinned. And that sin, the Bible tells us, separates us from God. The only way we can get have a right relationship with a God who is absolutely holy is if that sin is dealt with in a just way. And so God made that way by sending his son to become a man, to walk this earth just like you and me, to deal with very real pains and griefs and sorrows. He himself to be subject. The God who spoke and the universe was created willingly said to these feeble men who he could snap his fingers and they would all die, nail my hands and feet to this cross. I must experience death. It is the only way for sin to be justly dealt with from a holy God's perspective. So God sent his son to die on the cross. And that all we have to do is place our faith in that finished work of Jesus, the person and work of Jesus Christ. And on that basis, we can be forgiven. That is absent in Paul's proclamation here at the Areopagus. What's Paul doing? What's going on? I'm going to draw further attention to this. I want to snap through my slides, but you're going to have to trust me on this. So why is the cross so important? In the very next city that he'll go to, we're going to get to this next week, he travels further south down into Corinth. In Corinth, and when he has a ministry there for 18 months, a year and a half, and he writes a letter to them later, and he says this. He goes, "And I," writing to the Corinthians, right after he visited Athens, "and I, when I came to you, brothers, did not come proclaiming to you the testimony of God with lofty speech and wisdom." That's kind of what he did in Athens. "For I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified." The two things he left out in Athens. Did Paul struggle with this himself? The fact that only a few people came to faith? Was he considering, did I do the right thing there? It was never really the plan to go to Athens. I never really planned to engage these philosophers at the Areopagus. Did I use the right tactic? So you could see how people conjecture about this. If we continue to read other passages in Corinthians, he says this in verse 20, 1 Corinthians 1, 20. He says, "Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age?" This is the very next city. You got to think he must have this experience in mind back at Areopagus. "Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, it fell short. It pleased God through the folly of what we preach," Jesus and him crucified, "to save those who believe." That's the effective message. "For Jews demand signs and Greeks seek wisdom, but we preach Christ and him crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and folly to Gentiles," to the philosophers, to the Greeks. So I think, I'll tell you what I think. And there's a lot of views on this, so I'm just one of them, okay? I think that Paul, everything he said in Athens is fair game for us to employ the very same tactics. There's nothing that he's done. We could do them all. I think they're really legit, right? They're pointing out, where do we come from? It's answering the four basic questions of mankind, right? He's addressing it in ways that are very engaging. So I don't think that we should, first of all, look at the results and conclude, well, Paul did it wrong. I mean, I could offer a message today to come to faith in Jesus Christ, and there might be one person, there might be no person. That's well, most of you are believers here, right? So, you know, you can make it feel better by coming up. But the reality is, in our culture, we experience this a lot. We could tell people about Jesus all day long, and there's lots of times not a lot of result. And that necessarily is not necessarily the message itself. We have a free will. We have a choice. Choose God or reject him. So that's my first observation. Don't just look at the result. The second is, when Paul talked about the resurrection, it could have triggered a question instead of a accusation. It could have questioned, what do you mean resurrection? What do you mean about that? At which moment, Paul, maybe in his mind, would have launched in a complete understanding of the person of Jesus Christ and the necessity of the crucifixion. Maybe his message was cut short. They didn't ask that question. They just, that's it. We're here to the resurrection, and we're out of here. We're done. Oftentimes, when we are telling somebody about Jesus, we don't always get our full message out, right? Sometimes when we're talking to people and we only have a couple of sentences with someone we work with, you know, we just kind of work in little bits. My goodness, I'm a Christian man, and I said that, and on this, I'm sorry. Just have acknowledged. Sorry about that. My goodness. I'm a pastor. Goodness. Okay. And it's being recorded for the world to see. We're going to edit that. Jonathan, can you edit that part out, please? The bits of information that we give to people, we're going to give truths about God in our life, in life, in a life circumstance that we don't always have the opportunity to give the full gospel. Sometimes, you know, it feels very plastic and awkward to, I only have 2 minutes with you, let me explain the whole gospel to you right now because I just may not see you again. Like, whoa, do you have my best interest in mind or you just want to get this off your chest, you know? So there's a variety of ways that we can present the gospel, and we're depending on the fact that if I give you a bit of truth today, I'm praying that God is going to use somebody else to give you another bit of truth tomorrow. And the next day, and the next day, and the next day. Because every single one of us probably have some sense of our own story that it wasn't just one experience that we heard the gospel and responded. But we had multiple experiences of God kind of ticking away at our conscience and our thoughts and our life experience and using a variety of people and a variety of places that finally one experience, either at a church or a revival or in somebody's living room, we placed our faith in Jesus Christ. So I think, my opinion, Paul wasn't off base. Should we work hard to include Jesus and the cross? It is vital to the gospel message. So the answer is yes. We can't avoid that. But Paul acknowledges that's foolishness to Gentiles and a stumbling block to Jews. No one wants to hear the message of the cross. No one wants to hear about Jesus dying for you. Because it means that I need something. I have problems. I'm broken. I'm estranged to God, but I think I'm still a pretty good guy, person. We have to deal with that, and that's not easy. But the truth is that we need Jesus. He died on the cross for a reason. Every single one of us need our sin forgiven to have a relationship with God. So the last passage, and I'm way over time. This guy is such a long speaker. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18. I'm back in Corinthians, but all the way to chapter 3. It's going to conclude with this. Let no one deceive himself. This is Paul's statement in Corinth, the next town down, city. Let no one deceive himself. If anyone among you thinks that he is wise in this age, let him become a fool, that he may become truly wise. If the cross of Christ is foolishness, let me be a fool. Because in the end, when the last person standing or before God, I will be the one who is declared truly wise. I made the decision for Jesus. And so we're gonna end our time here. I'm going to invite Sierra to come on up. She's going to dismiss us with a benediction. But let's stand together. I cannot give you that message and not give you an opportunity. If you have not placed your faith in Jesus, don't wait another day. Today is your day. We're not going to have a big altar call this morning, but we are definitely going to give you the opportunity. Talk to me. Talk to Sierra. We would love to explain more about this wonderful faith and freedom that can come through a faith in Jesus Christ. And so, So, Sierra, would you dismiss us, please?
Benedictions out of Jude, verses 24 and 25. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, and dominion, and authority before all time, now and forever. Amen.